So, Ms. Rocher, can I call you Lubomira?
Oh, yes, you can.
Lubomira.
Especially in my hometown.
Yes.
Well, my birth town.
You're French Bulgarian.
I'm Bulgarian, yeah.
Nice. Well, welcome back.
Thank you.
You get applause for being Bulgarian. That's amazing. I never get applause for being Belgian. What's it? There you go. Thank you. So, welcome. What is L'Oréal? Pitch it like it's a startup.
Oh, shit. Oh, no, I can't do that. Like
closer to the...
So, L'Oréal is the world leader in beauty.
All right.
Working across all categories. So, makeup. Even men are using makeup now. You know that?
Even men.
Yeah, yeah,
wow.
Yeah. Foundation, after 2 hours sleep,
wow,
you would,
we should try
would be
that.
Great to you.
Yeah, I can use
so
it too.
Across,
yeah,
across all categories, so makeup, skincare, hair color, hair care, perfume. And yeah, we are the world leader in beauty.
That's great. So what are you doing at a tech conference?
It's a good question. They invited me. My mom was here, so I came. No. So what are we doing in tech conference? We have embarked since like 6 years in L'Oréal in a massive digital transformation. So putting digital at the heart of everything we do, especially in marketing, in go-to-market through e-commerce, data, and also investing in beauty tech. And we recently bought a company called Modiface in Toronto, which is specialized in augmented reality and artificial intelligence to produce those new services that I'm sure you guys crave for. I'm sure you do. Those virtual makeup try-ons, those hair color try-ons, those skin diagnostic that can allow us to really personalize our product recommendation.
Great. Well, we're going to talk about this a little more, but maybe first, your background. You haven't been at L'Oréal that long, four years?
4 years.
So what did you do before?
So I'm an economist by training, so a little bit of love for data came from there. And then I went to Capgemini to start my career, so big, hardcore tech projects, IT projects. And then I went to Microsoft, and I headed the innovation and startup programs there, and then I run a digital agency called Valtech, and here I am.
Right. And now you're the chief digital officer of L'Oréal.
Yes, I am.
What does that mean?
Okay, that's a good question. That's a question my mom keeps asking every time. So
is she here?
She's here.
Oh, nice.
Hello, Mom.
Well, maybe she'll finally get an answer.
So basically...
what do you do at L'Oréal? Come on.
So basically, what we are doing is we are working across four big topics. First is acceleration of e-commerce, because obviously more and more people want to shop online, and even they want to shop beauty online. So today it's like 2.1 billion of our revenue. It's 8% of our turnover. The second thing is even more challenging, I would say, is to put personalization of everything at the heart of our strategy. We used to be a mass marketer. Now we put data and personalization at the heart of everything we do, which means that we personalize our content, we personalize our advertising, we personalize our CRM, we personalize everything that can be personalized. The third thing that we are doing is we are massively reshuffling our marketing models. We used to be a pure advertiser, so doing 30-second TVCs, TV spots, 15-second TV spots, print, and now we are doing that with a lot of excitement, and we are also doing all the rest, which means that we stuff Facebook and YouTube and Snapchat and Instagram and Baidu and whatever with a lot of content, new forms of content, shorter, more impactful. So it's a huge revolution in terms of us becoming a content publisher and an influencer marketer.
Great.
And the fourth thing we are doing is exactly what I told you about beauty tech and putting services on top of products at the heart of our business models.
What about digitizing the processes internally? Is that also something that you...
Yeah, we
are
do that too.
For?
We do that too. Huge work happens in both R&D, in putting essentially artificial intelligence in formulation, for example, faster formulation, which is obviously a competitive advantage for us. Supply chain gets super disrupted with new technologies. Obviously, everything that is internal communication. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Great. So you mentioned these four pillars. Which one is the most challenging, in your opinion, after 4 years in your role?
I mean, they were all challenging, but in different ways. E-commerce was challenging because, you know, when you're a country manager at L'Oréal and your e-commerce represents like 0.7% of your revenue, you're like, that's very important. My CEO is really behind it. This blonde lady, she's really pushing for it, but like it's, Jesus, it's 0.7% of my revenue. So the whole thing of telling them and educating everyone, saying that e-commerce is the biggest growth source in this company. I mean, e-commerce accounted for 45% of our growth last year. And putting resources behind it is challenging. So this is one. For data, it's hugely challenging because L'Oréal didn't have any data, didn't hold any data. We were a B2B manufacturer, so we were selling products to retailers who would sell those products to our consumers. And those, the retailers or the intermediaries would hold the data. So we didn't have teams, we didn't have systems in place to recoup all those data, and today we have huge amounts of data. We have like 1 billion visitors on our website. We have 1.6 billion cookies in our databases, so it's a lot. And it was challenging to put data at the heart of the marketing model and to invest in teams, in systems, etc. On marketing, it's hugely challenging because, again, we were the master of the world of the 30-second TV spots, you remember, with the hair helicopter, because I'm worth it and all of that. And now we have to produce between 50 and 100% times the number of contents that we used to. So we are creating content factories everywhere. And tech didn't exist. I mean, it was not a technology company, and now we are acquiring technology companies. So it's a huge shift.
Right. You were in a corporate environment before at Microsoft, but Microsoft, of course, is a technology company. So when you arrive at a company like L'Oréal, you know, big group, lots of brands, but very historical, very large, very spread, very fragmented. How much buy-in do you have from the top management? Like, how hard do you have to fight internally to get the things done that you want?
So I'm in that sense, I'm super lucky because my CEO, Monsieur Jean-Paul Agon, was not only... I worked at an agency, and so I worked with many clients. And you have two types of CEOs, the ones who are like, yeah, digital, this digital thing is really important. It's great in PR. So they do a lot of things great in PR. Google Glasses, Periscopes, stuff, yeah, style of stuff. And then at some point, you have those CEOs who understand that digital is going to change profoundly the business and the business model. And I'm lucky because I found the second category. So I had full support from my CEO and still have, which is very important. The thing is, it's great, it's just essential, but it's not enough. Then you have to convince many other people. In the case of L'Oréal, you have to convince all brand managers, the head of brands. We have 35 of them. You have to convince all country managers. We have 70 of them. And you have to convince, in fact, everyone that digital is the future of their business. So this whole work is pretty intense. And you have to fight. Yeah, you have to fight. Although I'm lucky because, again, L'Oréal is a company that has embraced change naturally and pretty enthusiastically. The real challenge comes from the fact that those guys, I mean, they have not worked in digital before.
Right.
So when you're like, okay, you have your digital manager coming to you saying like, oh, Robin, my video went viral. I had 20 million views. And you're like, is that good or not? You don't have any
benchmark.
And then if it was me, the next question I would say, yeah, and how percentage of organic view did you have? But the country manager didn't know that. So the whole thing was really upskilling and reskilling people. So that was a big, big focus of my work and of our work as a team for a long time.
Is it mostly upskilling the people that you have? Is it also hiring new types of profiles?
Yeah, it's both. So again, you really have to upskill people, and we upskilled 20,000 of them. On digital and with very hands-on practice. It's not just super PowerPoints. It's really like taking them to startups, do intense reverse mentoring programs. It's about gamification. So we invented a game where those guys and sometimes country managers, sometimes even ex-com members, they would come and they would be in charge of a wine selling website. So they would go and do their SEO campaign, their SEM campaign, they would go for Facebook page, and they would build it. So the thing is, again, through those very hands-on programs, you get a feel of what it is. So yeah, upskilling was a great part of it. And the second was obviously recruitment. And we recruited 2,000 people, including myself, to drive this digital transformation.
Great. So well, that's internal. But obviously, you have the outward-facing initiatives. You mentioned startups. I was actually surprised that you have so many initiatives going on. Because usually, when a corporate kind of decides we're going to work with startups, they pick one, right? They do an accelerator, or they start a venture arm, or they have an acquisition strategy. You kind of have all of that, right? Because you invested in a VC fund, in an accelerator. And actually, I'm going to let you explain all the things you do.
Yeah, the thing is, again, we are a big company. We are doing 26 billion revenue, 86,000 people, 60 countries, 35 brands, 70 countries, 35 brands. And it's a very decentralized company. The thing is, I mean, the corporate has limited power, and the operations are really located in the country. So that's one explanation for doing many things. The other explanation is we believe that it's complicated. I mean, startup world is so big and so creative and so fast that you need to have several antennas to be connected to that world. So basically what we did is we invested in an accelerator in London called Founders Factory, created by the team from lastminute.com, so super exciting. We invested in a VC, Partech, based in France but with operations in Germany and also in the US. And we also created our own accelerator slash incubator in Station F, so that's a big thing in France. And we are also having local initiatives. So we had the big VivaTech forum last week in Paris, and we had startups coming from China, from Germany, from the UK, from the US. So we have all of those are like antennas that allow us to connect ourselves to local ecosystems and to make sure that we meet the right people. Yeah. So this is why I'm here too.
But what's the reason for you to work with startups? Is it for the return on investment through the accelerator of the VC? Is it for keeping your ears to the ground in a way, like keeping track of innovation? Is it to identify companies you can acquire? Like, what's the main reason for working with startups?
A little bit of all of that.
No, well, what's the main one?
So the main one, I would say, so we are not acquiring tech companies every day. So I would say the main one is really to keep our fingers on the pulse and to understand what are the next technologies coming, because you can have that coming from analysts like, you know, Gartner, Forrester, etc., which is very valuable. But it's also very good to be connected to the next wave of innovations. So we are looking especially at things like, you know, augmented reality, artificial intelligence, data, ad tech, super important for us. We are the third advertiser worldwide, so everything that's related to ad tech, super important. Measurement, omnichannel, we are a retailer. Conversational commerce, etc. So we have a variety of themes we are really looking at, and we are also exploring not only beauty tech but also cosmetic startups. And so in one case, beauty tech, it's really about finding those great technologies that we can embed in our own experiences, in our own websites, or in our partnering with startups and creating good business for them. And on the beauty startups, it's more with a vision of investment or even acquisition at some point.
Right. You mentioned the acquisition in the beginning.
Yep.
Can you elaborate on which company you bought and why you bought them?
So we bought a company called Modiface. So Modiface is a Toronto-based company. It's 80 engineers, really specialized in augmented reality, tracking, rendering, and AI now, because obviously it's linked. And those guys have been in business for 10 years, specialized in beauty. And we've worked with those guys for many years. And at some point, we realized as a group that augmented reality was so fundamental in the future of our business, in terms of the future of the consumer experience, that we were like, okay, it's great, we have a great partnership, but it's so strategic that we want to in-house that capability. And so now we are really working, it's a few months old. So we are really working on integration and making sure that L'Oréal doesn't wait on such a startup.
Right.
So we are putting in place all the guardrail and the safeguards to make sure that those guys keep innovative, cool, startup-minded, and innovative.
So you mentioned that you were going from sort of a mass market marketer positioning to personalized.
Yep.
Customized marketing. Obviously, last week was a pretty big week in terms of data privacy and regulation.
Yeah.
So how is the GDPR affecting the way that you work?
But it has affected us, but like everybody else. I mean,
yeah,
it was a big
business in Europe.
Yeah, it was a big reshuffle of all our processes. To be honest, I think it's really good that it happened, because, I mean, obviously it's challenging, but it's very good, because I think that ethics needs to be at the heart of our relationship. Trust is a new currency, and so ethics should be at the heart of our relationship with our customers. They are visiting us on our websites, on our apps, on our stores. They are giving us data that are very personal, navigation data, but sometimes diagnostic data, like very personal. So we must make sure as a company that we manage them with care. So it was a one-year hardcore project, also in terms of reshuffling of the IT systems. Obviously, cleaning all the databases, putting consent. We worked with OneTrust to do that across all our properties. And in Europe, just in Europe, I mean, the whole scope, we have more than 500 websites, just to give you an idea of the scope of that work. And but more importantly, it's more about like rethinking the way we interact with our customers. And I think that the whole ad tech market had gone too far in terms of data privacy. So I think it's good to come back to a new normal.
Sure. Well, I can only agree. But what are you mentioned the company that you've bought, of course, is innovation. What are some of the other things? Because I don't know much about the beauty tech space, so enlighten me. What are some of the innovations that you see from startups that you wish you could bring in-house to L'Oréal?
I think the big thing is really around augmented reality, because again, I mean, the way to everything is linked to the way you discover products in beauty or in food, or I mean, in every FMCG company. The key point is how do you discover products and how do you discover brands? I mean, 30 years ago, it was through TV. It was through print and it was through, mass market and hypermarkets and point of sales. Like the whole first phase of the digital stuff, the digital revolution, was really about Google, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and that was huge. And this is today the way people search, the way people discover products. I'm absolutely convinced that in the future, the whole services, so that this capacity to go on a website and to scan your face, make sure that you have a proper diagnostic, very precise in terms of your skin, hydration, wrinkles, pores, pigmentation. I'm not going to get into details here, but having this diagnostic is very powerful because it's very personalized. It's not like, oh, you should try that cream. It's you should try that cream because this cream is is absolutely made for you. And we go even one step further now because we have started to explore custom-made products, which means that basically you can take a diagnostic and then we will produce on the spot, on retail, a foundation or a skincare product just made for you based on a combination of serums and colors that is really made for your skin, for your type of skin. So for me, services and custom made and personalization and product personalization is really, really the future. This is really where we're investing right now.
Great. For the startup founders in the room, what advice would you give them when they have to work with a corporate or they have to engage in strategic discussions with a corporate? What are some of the lessons that you want to give them when engaging with a bigger company?
I think find the right entry point, the guy who has the budget.
It's her.
Because the thing is, when you are a startup, sometimes you lose a lot of time because in those matrixed organization, I mean, you talk to hundreds of people. Those people are nice and they're super interested in what you do, but they don't have the same relationship to time and money that you do.
Yeah.
So for you, time is of the essence. So find the right entry point. I think it's very important. And I think that if you don't find it, go for another one. Like really. Because if not, you lose a lot of time.
Yeah. Have you seen startups make that mistake quite often?
Yeah, of course. Of course. And again...
So they come in with the wrong expectations of time and resources and how important this is for the corporate, right?
Yeah. And the thing is, again, usually now big corporations tend to have startup programs. So usually that's a good entry point. Be ready to be very concrete in terms of how your product or your service is bringing value to the corporate, and make sure that you pitch not on trends or on big things that are coming to the market or stuff, but like really on my product in your environment, this is what it does. Like it's very, very concrete, because sometimes pitches are very abstract or very theoretical or very trend based. Usually, when I was at Microsoft, I was receiving hundreds of startups, and I usually say, You have different types of pitch. You have the pitch that is really tech-driven, like, I have found this great technology that's going to change the world forever for the better, and this is really tech-driven. Usually when you have marketing people, or it's complicated, they don't get it. The second type of pitch is the consultant, the McKinsey type of pitch. or whoever else, is like, I have spotted on this, you know, matrix thing, the right corner, it's going to be $1 billion business, I'm going to create a startup on this one, which is a very different way. And then you have the third type of pitch, which is, I have identified a problem at a consumer level or at a B2B level, and I have designed a solution for you. And this is what my stuff does. And this is very powerful.
Great. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you,
Robin. And I'm going to say this in Bulgarian. Merci.
Merci.
It's the same, right? Thank you.
Thank you.